Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Basic Bible Prophecy, Essential Facts Every Christian Should Know, by Ron Rhodes, narrated by David Cochran Heath. Introduction. Basic Bible Prophecy. Dear reader, if you have ever shied away from studying Bible prophecy because you thought it was too big a topic, or perhaps too controversial with too many conflicting views, this book is for you. I take the complicated and make it simple. You may consider this book Bible Prophecy Made Plain. It may be that you have studied Bible prophecy before, but you are still confused by it. If that is the case, this book can help you dispel your confusion. You will quickly gain clarity and become conversant on all the big issues of prophecy. I will function as your Bible prophecy tour guide. I will help you understand what you need to know while avoiding unnecessary clutter. Reading this book will enable you to grasp, perhaps for the first time, both the big picture of Bible prophecy and the most important finer details. The charts and visuals throughout the book will help keep things simple. In this book, I will examine the who, what, when, where, and why of Bible prophecy. You may think of these categories as different vantage points for studying this important subject. Different vantage points are a good thing. A police officer who writes up a report on a fender bender will typically interview several witnesses. Each witness has a different vantage point. The officer might interview one person who was walking along the sidewalk when the accident occurred. He might interview another person driving in the car behind the vehicle involved in the accident. He might also interview the person who was looking out the office window at the exact moment the accident occurred. And of course, he will interview the people involved in the accident. By combining the statements from people with different vantage points, the officer has a much better understanding of what occurred. The same is true as we study Bible prophecy. By considering the who, what, when, where, and why, we will have a much better understanding of Bible prophecy. I hope you find this to be true as you go through the book. As a bonus, each chapter will close with some bullet points that summarize the big ideas that you need to remember. It will also include some questions for reflection that will help you think through the significance of what you have learned. I think you will find the book to be an enriching experience. If you are like me, you will soon discover that an understanding of Bible prophecy can be life-changing. My exposure to biblical prophecy was a big contributing factor to my becoming a Christian way back in the 1970s. As a new Christian, I found that the more I studied Bible prophecy, the more I came to understand that God truly knows the future. The Bible, which contains God's prophecies of the future, is the Word of God, and you can trust it. God is in sovereign control of all that occurs in the world. God has a plan for humanity, and He has a plan for you and me. God will one day providentially cause good to triumph over evil. A new world is coming, a new earth and new heavens, a new city in which to live, the New Jerusalem, and new resurrection bodies that never age, get sick, or die. We will experience a joyful reunion with all our Christian loved ones in the afterlife. The Lord is coming sooner than we think. Factors such as these make this book extremely relevant. Our God is an awesome God. One of the most significant benefits growing out of my personal study of Bible prophecy is my ever-growing understanding of the awesomeness of God. I think you will experience this benefit as well. The God who knows the future is wondrous, majestic, and glorious. He is the first and the last. There is no other God. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6. The prophet Daniel exulted, "Praise the name of God forever and ever, for He has all wisdom and power. He controls the course of world events. He removes kings and sets up other kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the scholars. He reveals deep and mysterious things and knows what lies hidden in darkness, though He is surrounded by light." Daniel chapter 2, verses 20 through 22. Our awesome God is all-knowing. He perceives the past and the future with equal clarity. God's knowledge of all things is from the vantage point of eternity. The past, Isaiah chapter 41, verse 22, present, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13, and future, Isaiah chapter 46, verse 10, are all encompassed in one ever-present now to Him. He sees all. God knows all things, both actual and possible, Matthew chapter 11, verses 20 through 24. Because He knows all things, there can be no increase or decrease in His knowledge. Psalm 147, verse 5, affirms that His understanding is beyond comprehension. See also Psalm 33, verses 13 through 15, Psalm 139, verses 11 through 12, Proverbs chapter 15, verse 3, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 14, Acts chapter 15, verse 18, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13, and 1 John chapter 3, verse 20. Such verses reveal we can trust God when He communicates prophecies about the future to us. Never doubt it. Scripture also portrays God as being sovereign. He rules the universe, controls all things, and is Lord over all, Ephesians chapter 1. There is nothing that can happen in this universe beyond the reach of His control. All forms of existence are under His absolute dominion. Psalm 66, verse 7 affirms that by His great power He rules forever. Psalm 93, verse 1 affirms that the Lord is King. God Himself asserts, "Everything I plan will come to pass, for I do whatever I wish," Isaiah chapter 46, verse 10. God assures us, "It will all happen as I have planned. It will be as I have decided," Isaiah chapter 14, verse 24. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9 tells us, "We can make our plans, but the Lord determines our steps." Proverbs chapter 19, verse 21 likewise says, "You can make many plans, but the Lord's purpose will prevail." One of my favorite professors at Dallas Theological Seminary was the late Dr. Robert Leitner, affectionately known as Lightning Bob among his students. In one of his books, he offered this great perspective on God's sovereign oversight of human history. When viewed from the perspective of Scripture, history is more than the recording of the events of the past. Rather, what has happened in the past, what is happening now, and what will happen in the future is all evidence of the unfolding of the purposeful plan devised by the personal God of the Bible. All the circumstances of life, past, present, and future, fit into the sovereign plan like pieces of a puzzle. C.S. Lewis, once a professor at Oxford University, sums it up nicely. History is a story written by the finger of God. His point was that God controls the nations. Job chapter 12, verse 23, Psalm 22, verse 28, and Daniel chapter 4, verse 17. He sets up kings and deposes them, Daniel chapter 2, verse 21. And He does all according to His sovereign plan, Acts chapter 4, verses 27 through 28. That means you can trust prophecy. Peace in the heart. My friends, supreme peace in the heart is the natural result of trusting that God is not only all-knowing, He also sovereignly oversees all that happens in the world. No matter what we may encounter, no matter how much we do not understand why certain things happen, and no matter how horrible the newspaper headlines may often seem to be, the knowledge that our sovereign God is in control of human history is like a firm anchor amid life's storms. We can be at peace no matter what the future may hold. I want you to remember this as we continue through the rest of this book. God does not want us to be fearful about the prophetic future. He wants us to have confidence and peace. When Jesus spoke to His followers about the prophetic future, He added these words, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, and trust also in Me." John chapter 14, verse 1. Remember, our personal relationship with Jesus gives us peace, no matter the external circumstances. Jesus affirmed, "I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart, and the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid." John chapter 14, verse 27. God's peace for Christians. We can have perfect peace. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3. Peace can guard the heart, Philippians chapter 4, verse 7. Peace can rule the heart, Colossians chapter 3, verse 15. We have peace in Christ, John chapter 16, verse 33. Do not be troubled, John chapter 14, verse 27. My experience has taught me this. The more I understand about the prophetic future, the greater is my sense of God's awesomeness, power, and might. The more I understand of God's awesomeness, power, and might, the greater is the peace in my heart. May it be the same for you. Part 1. How can we make sense of Bible prophecy? 1. How is Bible prophecy important? My primary focus in this book is on the who, what, when, where, and why of Bible prophecy. First, however, I wish to consider how we can make sense of Bible prophecy. Toward that end, I want to address some specific questions. How is Bible prophecy important? How can we understand last day's lingo? How do God's covenants relate to prophecy? How can we decide between a literal or allegorical approach? How can we properly interpret prophecy? How can we avoid prophetic imbalances? After we understand the how of Bible prophecy, the other broad categories, the who, what, when, where, and why, will make much better sense. Trust me, I've been studying prophecy for decades. We begin with the foundational question, how is Bible prophecy important? Studying Bible prophecy is important because it brings some great benefits. These benefits are part of the motivation for studying prophecy. You do not want to miss out on these benefits. Following are seven that are especially meaningful to me. 1. Prophecy proves God is the true God. The Bible reveals that one proof of the true God, in the face of many false gods and idols, is that He can predict the future. In Isaiah chapter 41, verses 21 through 23, God challenges people to supply proof that their worthless idols are really gods. Present the case for your idols, says the Lord. Let them show what they can do, says the King of Israel. Let them try to tell us what happened long ago, so that we may consider the evidence. Or let them tell us what the future holds, so we can know what's going to happen. Yes, tell us what will occur in the days ahead. These idols and false gods could not comply. By contrast, the true God says of Himself, "Everything I prophesied has come true, and now I will prophesy again. I will tell you the future before it happens." Isaiah chapter 42, verse 9. He later likewise affirmed, "I alone am God. I am God, and there is none like me. Only I can tell you the future before it even happens. Everything I plan will come to pass, for I do whatever I wish." Isaiah chapter 46, verses 9 through 10. 2. Prophecy proves the Bible is God's Word. Fulfilled prophecy shows that the Bible is, in fact, the Word of God and can be trusted. The logic is simple. 1. God alone knows the prophetic future. 2. God shares multiple specific prophecies of the future in the pages of the Bible and no other holy book. 3. Over 100 Old Testament messianic prophecies of Christ's first coming, the fulfillment of each one recorded in the pages of the New Testament, confirm God's 100% accuracy rate in foretelling the future. 4. Prophecy is thus a compelling proof that the Bible is God's Word and can be trusted. 3. Prophecy promotes evangelism. Prophecy can be a powerful evangelistic tool. We find a perfect example of this in Peter's sermon delivered on the day of Pentecost, after all kinds of supernatural phenomena had just occurred. Peter began his message by speaking about prophecy related to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon people. "What you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel," Acts chapter 2, verse 16. Later in the sermon, Peter moved into his evangelistic pitch. "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved," chapter 2, verse 21. The result? Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all, chapter 2, verse 41. I can personally confirm the powerful effect of Bible prophecy as a tool of evangelism. In my teens, I was a member of a liberal Christian church. I had never trusted in Christ for salvation. Everything changed once I started to study Bible prophecy. Prophecy got my attention. I not only became a true believer in Jesus, but I became insatiably hungry for God's Word. The study of prophecy was a significant turning point in my life. 4. Prophecy comforts us in our grief. Prophecy can have a profoundly positive effect on us when we lose a Christian loved one in death. The Thessalonian Christians had lost some of their loved ones and asked the Apostle Paul whether they would experience the rapture, that glorious future event in which the dead in Christ will be resurrected and living Christians will be instantly translated into their resurrection bodies, and both groups will be caught up to meet Christ in the air and taken back to heaven. John chapter 14, verses 1 through 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 through 54, and 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 17. Since these Christians were so concerned about the matter, Paul provided them a full explanation. Dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever. So encourage each other with these words. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. Of course, it is natural for us to still experience grief when a Christian loved one dies. But we will not grieve like people who have no hope. We know that a reunion is coming. We will be with our Christian loved ones again. Someone said, "No two Christians will ever meet for the last time." I think that is true. 5. Prophecy can strengthen believers facing adversity. The original recipients of the prophetic book of Revelation were Christians who lived about 65 years after Jesus experienced crucifixion and then was raised from the dead. Many of these were second-generation Christians, and the challenges they faced were enormous. Their lives had become increasingly difficult because of Roman hostilities against Christianity. The recipients of the book were suffering from persecution, and some of them were even being martyred. Revelation chapter 2, verse 13. Unfortunately, things were about to get even worse. The book of Revelation was intended to give these believers a strong sense of hope that would help them patiently endure amid relentless suffering. Human suffering is temporal, but our eternal life with God is forever. As my old friend Walter Martin used to put it, "I read the last chapter in the book, and we win." We need to keep this in mind whenever we face adversity. 6. Prophecy proves God will triumph over evil. Part of the big win for believers is that in the afterlife, the Antichrist, the false prophet, and Satan will experience eternal quarantine in the lake of fire. Revelation chapter 19, verse 20, and chapter 20, verse 10. Meanwhile, resurrected believers, no longer having a sin nature, will live directly in God's presence in the New Jerusalem, the eternal city of the redeemed. Look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. And the one sitting on the throne said, "Look, I am making everything new." Revelation chapter 21, verses 3 through 5. Evil will be gone forever. 7. Prophecy brings special blessings. Right at the beginning of the book of Revelation, we are told, "God blesses the one who reads the words of this prophecy to the church, and he blesses all who listen to its message and obey what it says, for the time is near. Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. This is the first of seven pronouncements of special blessing in the book of Revelation. See chapter 14, verse 13, chapter 16, verse 15, chapter 19, verse 9, chapter 20, verse 6, and chapter 22, verses 7 and 14. You will notice from these verses that obedience brings the blessing. We should not be just hearers of God's prophetic word, but doers of it. James chapter 1, verses 22 through 25. My friends, I share all this so you won't consider the study of prophecy just an academic exercise. It not only informs the brain, but it also deeply touches the heart. Our lives can change for the better because of studying Bible prophecy. Don't miss out. The big ideas. Prophecy proves God is the true God. Prophecy proves the Bible is God's Word and can be trusted. Prophecy promotes evangelism. Prophecy comforts us in our grief. Prophecy can strengthen believers facing adversity. Prophecy proves God will triumph over evil. Prophecy can bring special blessings. Questions for reflection. 1. What are three of the most meaningful things you learned about prophecy in this chapter? 2. What changes might you want to make in your life in view of what you have learned about prophecy so far? 2. How can we understand last days lingo? When I first became a Christian as a teenager, I had a discussion with a friend about Bible prophecy. We knew next to nothing about the subject. We were newbies, wet behind the ears in every way. We had no idea what we were talking about. At that time, all we had was a King James Bible. So we opened it one day and read a prophecy in Luke chapter 21, verse 11, that affirmed, "Great earthquakes shall be in divers places." At first, we thought there might be underwater earthquakes, where divers go. And then it suddenly dawned on us, "Oh, wait a minute. This must be an old English way of referring to diverse places, as in different places." All these years later, having taught many Christians about Bible prophecy, I can tell you that it is easy to get confused over prophecy lingo. Terms like eschatology and apocalyptic can seem like a foreign language to some people. We might call that foreign language Christianese. If you are new to Bible prophecy, some of these Christianese terms may be unfamiliar to you. That is okay. No problem. I authored this book to make things simple. I will explain it all. You will soon be conversant in basic Bible prophecy, and you will be able to impress your friends with big words like eschatology and apocalyptic. Understanding prophets. The word prophet comes from the Hebrew word nabi. You do not need to remember that. The thing you do need to remember is that a prophet is a spokesman for God. And that spokesman typically had two roles in Bible times. One, sometimes God's prophets directed their words at specific contemporary situations or problems that needed attention back in Bible times. Their message might be as simple as "stop sinning" or "turn back to God." Two, at other times, God's prophets foretold the future, based on divine revelation. See 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 27, and Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 18. In both cases, the prophets typically prefaced their words with, "Thus saith the Lord." Their words were not their own, but came from God. The divine source of their words gave their words authority. There are cases in the Old Testament where God's human messenger spoke forth a prophetic word, and in the New Testament we are told that God is the one who said it. This proves that God was the ultimate source of their prophetic words. God speaks through the prophets. Old Testament reference. Psalmist said, Psalm 95, verse 7. New Testament reference. Holy Spirit said, Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7. Old Testament reference. Psalmist said, Psalm 45, verse 6. New Testament reference. God said, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8. Old Testament reference. Psalmist said, Psalm 102, verses 25 and 27, New Testament reference, God said, Hebrews chapter 1, verses 10 through 12. Old Testament reference, Isaiah said, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. New Testament reference, the Lord spoke by the prophet, Matthew chapter 1, verses 22 through 23. Old Testament reference, Hosea said, Hosea chapter 11, verse 1. New Testament reference, the Lord spoke by the prophet, Matthew chapter 2, verse 15. Old Testament reference, Eliphaz's words, Job chapter 5, verse 13. New Testament reference, God's word, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 19. These men did not just wake up one day and say, I want to be a prophet. Rather, God himself called the prophets into service, Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, and Luke chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. These prophets came from all walks of life, from farmers, Amos chapter 7, verse 14, to princes, Genesis chapter 23, verse 6. Whatever their background, the prophets were messengers of the Lord, Isaiah chapter 44, verse 26, who served God and shepherded God's people, Amos chapter 3, verse 7, Zechariah chapter 11, verses 4 and 7, and Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 16. Messages of judgment or comfort. Some prophets carried out their work before Israel went into captivity. Captivity involved bondage to another, more powerful country as a form of God's disciplinary judgment on Israel. Because of Israel's sin and complacency, these prophets warned that a time of judgment was coming. God would not allow the sins of his people to continue. See, for example, Amos chapter 9, verses 1 through 10. Though the prophets called the people to repentance, the people became hardened in their sin, and disciplinary judgment therefore inevitably came. They went into captivity. An example is the Jewish captivity in Babylon, Daniel chapter 1. When the people of Israel perceived that God had allowed their bondage because of their sins, they became despondent as they realized they had ultimately brought this on themselves. The prophets, therefore, spoke soothing words of comfort, promising that God still had a plan for their future and would one day deliver them from their suffering. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 13, chapter 28, verse 5, chapter 29, verse 5, and chapter 31, verse 5. Different styles. Prophets received messages from God in various ways, including visions, dreams, and even hearing God's voice. Likewise, the prophets used multiple means in delivering their messages. Sometimes they might deliver a simple proclamation in a sanctuary. At other times, they might speak face to face with an individual. And at other times, they might act out their message. See Jeremiah chapter 19. Isaiah even went barefoot and naked for 3 years in pointing to the embarrassing shame of his people. Isaiah chapter 20, verses 2 through 3. Yes, I know, that is bizarre. Regardless of the means the prophets used in delivering their messages, God expected the people to hear and obey. Major and minor prophets. There are two categories of prophets. The major prophets were Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. These guys were the big wheels. The minor prophets were Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. These guys were the small fries. Nevertheless, their words were just as much from God as the divine words the major prophets received. God spoke through all of them. The prophets never made mistakes when speaking for God. Some people claim the prophet Jonah made a mistake when he prophesied that God would overthrow Nineveh in 40 days. Jonah's prediction did not come to pass. Jonah did not make a mistake, however, for he told the Ninevites precisely what God told him to say. See Jonah chapter 3, verses 1 through 2. There was apparently a repentance clause built into Jonah's prophecy. The Ninevites understood that God would overthrow Nineveh in 40 days unless they repented. Jonah chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. Based on how the Ninevites responded in repentance to Jonah's prophecy, God withdrew the threatened punishment. Let me clue you in to an important Bible passage. In Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 7 through 8, God himself affirmed, If I announce that a certain nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down, and destroyed, but then that nation renounces its evil ways, I will not destroy it as I had planned. This is the repentance clause I was talking about. Nineveh renounced its evil, and God responded with mercy. See Exodus chapter 32, verse 14, 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 16, and Amos chapter 7, verses 3 and 6. God always loves to show mercy where repentance is evident. The biblical prophets were always 100% accurate. If a prophet was less than 100% accurate, the people stoned him to death as a false prophet. Deuteronomy chapter 13 and chapter 18, verses 20 through 22. God's prophets. Jonah, 781 BC, prophesied to Nineveh. Amos, 765 to 754 BC, prophesied to Israel. Isaiah, 760 to 673 BC, prophesied to Judah. Hosea, 758 to 725 BC, prophesied to Israel. Micah, 738 to 698 BC, prophesied to Judah. Nahum, 658 to 615 BC, prophesied about Nineveh. Jeremiah, 650 to 582 BC, prophesied to Judah. Zephaniah, 640 to 626 BC, prophesied to Judah. Ezekiel, 620 to 570 BC, prophesied in Babylon. Daniel, 620 to 540 BC, prophesied in Babylon. Habakkuk, 608 to 598 BC, prophesied to Judah. Obadiah, 590 BC, prophesied about Edom. Zechariah, 522 to 509 BC, prophesied to Judah. Haggai, 520 BC, prophesied to Judah. Malachi, 465 BC, prophesied to Judah. Joel, 450 BC, prophesied to Judah. Prophecy. Now that we know what a prophet is, allow me to add just a few words about prophecy, especially predictive prophecy of the future. Some Bible experts define prophecy in modern vernacular as history written in advance. I think it is more precise to say that prophecy is God's revelation regarding history in advance, for only God, in His omniscience, His all-knowingness, knows the future. God makes this claim in Isaiah chapter 46, verses 9 through 11. Remember the things I have done in the past, for I alone am God. I am God, and there is none like me. Only I can tell you the future before it even happens. Everything I plan will come to pass, for I do whatever I wish. I have said what I would do, and I will do it. The word prophesy, as opposed to prophecy, means to set forth prophecies. Everything God prophesies eventually comes to pass. You can count on it. God makes this claim in Isaiah chapter 48, verse 3. Long ago I told you what was going to happen. Then suddenly I took action, and all my predictions came true. He likewise affirms in Isaiah chapter 42, verses 8 through 9, I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not give my glory to anyone else, nor share my praise with carved idols. Everything I prophesied has come true, and now I will prophesy again. I will tell you the future before it happens. These verses reveal that our sovereign God controls human history. What He predicts or prophesies always comes to pass. He is the only one who can show the future to us. And He does this through prophecies recorded in the pages of the Bible. A case study, fulfilled prophecies of the past. Many of the prophecies God set forth in Old Testament times find fulfillment in New Testament times. For example, over 100 messianic prophecies find a literal fulfillment in the first coming of Jesus back in the first century. That is a lot. Jesus often showed His listeners He was the specific fulfillment of Old Testament messianic prophecy. He made the following comments to people on different occasions. This is all happening to fulfill the words of the prophets as recorded in the Scriptures. Matthew chapter 26, verse 56. Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining from all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Luke chapter 24, verse 27. When I was with you before, I told you that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and in the Psalms must be fulfilled. Luke chapter 24, verse 44. Jesus told some Jewish critics, "You search the scriptures because you think they give you eternal life, but the scriptures point to me." John chapter 5, verses 39 through 40. Jesus also said to some Jewish critics, "If you really believed Moses, you would believe me, because he wrote about me." John chapter 5, verses 46 through 47. We read of Jesus in a synagogue. He rolled up the scroll, handed it back to the attendant, and sat down. All eyes in the synagogue looked at him intently. Then he began to speak to them. "The scripture you've just heard has been fulfilled this very day." Luke chapter 4, verses 20 through 21. Among the literally fulfilled prophecies are that the Messiah would be born of a virgin, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, from the line of Abraham, Genesis chapter 12, verses 2 through 3, from the line of David, 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12 through 16, in the city of Bethlehem, Micah chapter 5, verse 2, suffer betrayal for 30 shekels of silver, Zechariah chapter 11, verse 12, suffer crucifixion for our sins, Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, while dying with criminals, Isaiah chapter 53, verse 12, and experience resurrection from the dead, Psalm 16, verse 10. Jesus fulfilled these and many more messianic prophecies in the Old Testament. Such fulfilled prophecies give us strong confidence to expect that prophecies of our future will find just as literal a fulfillment. God's fulfillment of past prophecies establishes an unbroken pattern of literal fulfillment. He has set a precedent. This leads me to a principle that you should never forget. If you want to understand how God will fulfill prophecy in the future, just take a look at how He has fulfilled prophecy in the past. What in the world is eschatology? Eschatology is a big fancy word used by theologians who teach in seminaries. It derives from two Greek words, eschatos, meaning last or last things, and logos, meaning study of. Eschatology is the study of last things. It is the study of the end times. It is the study of prophecy. I believe the study of eschatology is essential. I say this because 25% of Scripture was prophetic when first written. Many of these end-time Bible verses address the rapture, the tribulation period, the Antichrist, the false prophet, Armageddon, the second coming of Christ, and heaven and the afterlife. I will fully explain all these terms later in the book. There are two categories of eschatology. Personal eschatology concerns such things as death, the future judgment, heaven, and hell. These are matters that relate to each person. General eschatology concerns more general prophetic issues, such as the rapture, the tribulation period, and the second coming. Both categories of eschatology are important. What in the world is apocalyptic literature? Apocalyptic is another one of those big words theologians like to use in seminaries. But it is actually easy to understand. The Greek word for apocalypse means revelation or unveiling. Apocalyptic literature contains divine revelations that unveil the future. Apocalyptic literature arose among the Jews and Christians in Bible times to reveal certain mysteries about heaven and earth, especially about the world to come. Such literature features visions, the necessity of making ethical and moral decisions or changes because of these visions, and a pervasive use of symbols. Seven primary themes are common to apocalyptic literature. 1. A growing sense of hopelessness as wicked powers grow in strength. 2. The promise that God will intervene. 3. Heavenly visions that provide readers with a divine perspective that helps them endure present suffering. 4. The intervention of God in overcoming and destroying evil. 5. The call to believers to live righteously. 6. The call to believers to persevere under trial. 7. God's final deliverance and restoration, with the promise to dwell with his people forever. The book of Revelation is an excellent example of apocalyptic literature. It contains heavenly visions and provides hope, inspiration, and comfort to persecuted believers. It shows that God will ultimately win over evil and that Christians will one day live face to face with him in the afterlife. Another well-known apocalyptic book is Daniel. It has many prophecies of the end times. It tells us a lot about the tribulation period and the rise of the Antichrist. Daniel chapter 2, chapter 7, and chapter 9, verses 26 through 27. It is helpful to study the books of Revelation and Daniel side by side, in concert with each other. They complement each other rather well. The last days. Several New Testament passages use last days, last times, and last time to refer to the present church age in which we now live. For example, the writer of Hebrews says, "Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days he has spoken to us by his Son." Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 2. We also read of Christ in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, "God chose him as your ransom long before the world began, but now in these last days he has been revealed for your sake." These verses show that people in New Testament times up to the present day are, in some sense, already in the last days. The term has a different meaning in the Old Testament. Indeed, when the Old Testament uses the term, it prophetically refers to Israel in the 7-year tribulation period, after which the divine Messiah comes again and sets up his millennial kingdom on earth. See, for example, Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 30. As we study biblical prophecy,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.